and prosperous Dhanteras. May God bless you with as much as gold and money and all other things. Okay. Dear friends, today's topic that was given to me was the grounded theory. But I just like to take a few minutes just to build up the today's lecture, because it requires like background. So therefore, I'm sharing my, say, the word file to you people. Oh, sorry, it's not the file that I want to share with you. The file I want to share is, okay, that's right. This is the one. Okay, dear friends, I am DN Sansanwal, and that's my email address, dnsansanwal@email.com. Now, the topic assigned was grounded theory. Now, before I start this one, I just like to give you a brief, say, basics. And the basics that I want to take today is, they are something like this, that all of, I presume that all of you know what exactly is a research. And I'm sure you know the different characteristics of the research. If you do not, let me start. You know, if you see the word research, this word research, it comprises two words. One is re, which means again, and search. So you search again. Now the question arises, why do you search again? That means if you have something which you already have, why do you want to have again? Maybe the same, or maybe in a modified form of something like this. The reason might be that you may not be really happy about whatever you have. You want to have better. So that means if suppose you have a problem and you have a solution of the problem, for example, if I have fever, then you know there are many medicines available. And one medicine is, say, Aspirin, Novalgene, Paracetamol. The question arises, why are there so many medicines just for the fever? Because some medicine will suit to some, and some medicine will suit to some. So that is why you have a problem and you have one solution of the problem, but you want more solutions or a better solutions. So you start with a problem, and when you want to reach to the solution, you have to do some activity. And you have to do different activities. You know that if a person is not well, the different activities the family members will do is that either they will take the patient to the doctor or they will call the doctor, one activity. If they take the patient to the doctor, then doctor will examine the patient, another activity. After that, doctor will prescribe some medicine, another activity. The family members have to go to the chemist shop to bring those medicines, another activity, and then give those medicines as prescribed by them. So many activities are done. And these activities must be done in a particular sequence. And when you are doing it in a sequence, that is what is systematic. You have to do activity either in the systematic way or in the scientific. Normally in social science, people use the word systematic, and in science, people use the word scientific. It does not make a difference. You use any word you like. Now, whenever you do any activity systematically, then you are following certain steps, because you know the first activity you have to do, then second, then third, then fourth, etc., etc. And whenever you do these activities in a particular sequence, that's a process. Say when in the morning you brush your teeth. So brushing the teeth is a process, and you know the steps. When you take bath, taking bath is a process, you know the steps. When you are making chapati is a process, you know the steps. So these are the five words which are very, very important. And each word is the characteristics of the research. So therefore, if you have to define research, you have to use these five words. And therefore, you can say research refers to a process wherein activities are carried out systematically to find solution of the problem. Now, in this particular definition, the important words, I will just highlight one. The important word is a process. Another important word is activities. Another is systematic. And another is solution. And then the problem. You must understand that it is the problem, because for one particular problem, there may be more than one solutions. So that is why the problem remains the same and the solution may be different. Now, this is the general definition. And if you want to just convert this definition to fit into any other subject, then let me just modify and tell you how it is to be modified. If I say research in education refers to the process wherein activities are carried out systematically to find solution of the problem related to some aspect of education. Now, if suppose you want to say research in Hindi, then you can just modify that in place of education, you can say Hindi. Research in Hindi refers to a process wherein activities are carried out scientifically or systematically to find solution of problem related to some aspect of Hindi. Okay, so this is how you can still modify this definition so as to fit in science. If I say research in mathematics, refers to a process wherein activities are carried out systematically to find solution of problem related to some aspect of mathematics. So I hope you have understood now the general definition and how to mold this general definition so as to fit into different subjects. That of course is all right that you can do. Now, once we have understood the characteristics and the definition, then let us go to the types of the researches. This is very important. So let me just insert a table. So I'll say first, say the serial number, and then I will say the type, and then I will say the base. Say one type is, you say number one is qualitative research, and another is quantitative research. You know, the information as a researcher, what you have, you may have qualitative data or you may have a quantitative data. Say during COVID, if people ask you what are you doing these days, or what did you do during the lockdown period, then you tell, I played chess and I was watching the TV and I was reading and I was talking to my family. All these are the qualitative information that you are giving. You say that during the COVID period, I have been able to maintain my health. I have reduced 2 kg weight. This is a quantitative information you are giving. So therefore, the information in the research may be pure qualitative in nature, or maybe pure quantitative in nature, or maybe sometime some information may be qualitative and some information may be quantitative. So therefore, if the qualitative and quantitative are the types of the researches, the base is nature of data. Either you say nature of data or you say nature of information. You like. So you can say nature of the data or nature of the information. And your information may be qualitative and quantitative. Let me give one simple example. During examination, when you got the question paper, which you had, it was having the questions. And these questions were worded in words. It was a qualitative. The answer which you wrote was also qualitative. But your teacher, examiner, he read your answer in the context of the question. And then he gave marks. If it was 10 marks a question, then he might have given you 6 marks. So he has converted a qualitative information into quantitative. And this we can do it, and we have been doing it. So the qualitative data can be converted into quantitative. But from quantitative, you cannot get back the original qualitative. It's not possible. The person, the examiner who has given 6 marks in the answer of a question, if you ask that examiner, that can you reproduce the same answer in which you have given 6 marks. I'm sure you will agree with me that examiner will not be able to really reproduce the same answer in which he has given 6 marks. He may reproduce another answer in which 6 marks may be given, and some portion of his answer may resemble with some portion of the answer that he has checked. It is possible. So therefore, from qualitative data, you cannot get back the original, from quantitative data, you cannot get back the original quality. So never convert a qualitative data into quantitative. This is very important. There is another way to classify. One is, if you want to study the vision of any person, vision of Mahatma Gandhi, vision of Rabindranath Tagore, etc., etc., it will be a philosophical study. And this philosophical has got pure qualitative information. And you can never convert the qualitative information into quantitative. It's not possible. Another can be, if you want to study the past event, then it has to be historical. And your historical research may have the qualitative information, or it may have the quantitative information. The historical research will have more qualitative information, less quantitative information. Then another one is the survey research. That means if you have to see the present. In the present context, whenever you want to study any event, it has to be survey. You have to do the survey. The survey research can be of different type. It can be exploratory survey. It can be descriptive survey. And it can be correlational survey. Now, these are the three types of the surveys. Then the fourth one is anything which you use in the future. Whatever you use in the future is experimental. Now, during COVID period, the different pharmaceutical companies are doing experiments, trying to find out some vaccine for the COVID-19. So therefore, the experiments are being done. And once they find that whatever they have got the vaccine, it is effective, then not only then they will put it in the market for general use. So the experimental research findings will be used by the people only after it has been done. So it is to be used only in future. Then another, if you want to study something special, then this has to be a case study. Case study research. Now, dear friends, you have in the philosophical one, you have the qualitative information. In historical one, you have qualitative as well as quantitative. In survey, you have exploratory, you have descriptive, so you have the qualitative. But correlational, you have the quantitative. In experimental, you have the quantitative. And in case study, you have both the qualitative as well as quantitative. So in all these type of the things, again, you see that there will be qualitative information and quantitative information. You, in the philosophy, it is pure qualitative. As you proceed further, the qualitative decreases and quantitative increases. And the steps you follow in philosophical research, historical survey, experimental and case study, they differ. So therefore, you can differentiate them on the basis of methodology, or you can say steps followed. Now understand that you have the qualitative information. Here also you have the qualitative information. So therefore, when you conduct a research, you do have the qualitative information. It is not that you do not have the qualitative information. Now there is another way to classify them, and that is, one is known as the theoretical research. And this word is normally used by the people who belong to the science. The social science people, they normally use the basic research or they use fundamental. So it may be basic research, fundamental research or theoretical research. Another can be your applied research, experimental research. Or it can be called applied research. And the third is called action research. Why am I telling you all that is because it is related to the today's topic, and that is the qualitative research. Now you can see that you do have qualitative data. Okay, where the nature of information or data, it can be qualitative or quantitative. So qualitative data you have. Here also you have the qualitative data. In the philosophical, it's all qualitative data. In historical, maximum qualitative and some quantitative. In descriptive survey, it is all qualitative. But maybe some little quantitative, but correlational is 100% quantitative. Experimental is 100% quantitative, and case study may be some quantitative and qualitative. So therefore, qualitative information you do have. And here, if you say fundamental or theoretical, it's all qualitative information. The experimental research or applied research is all quantitative. Action research is quantitative. And this is, you can differentiate on the basis of degree of utility. Or you can say degree of applicability. Therefore, this is one thing which I thought I should tell you.
दीपावली हब इ हेलो डॉक्टर सनसनवाल सर, प्लीज अनम्यूट योर माइक, यू आर नॉट ऑडिबल।
नहीं, आई हैव अनम्यूटेड बट समबडी इज टॉकिंग ड्यूरिंग दी लेक्चर, सो प्लीज अनम्यूट योर, इफ यू वांट टू आस्क ए क्वेश्चन देन यू कैन आस्क, नो प्रॉब्लम एट ऑल, अदरवाइज प्लीज म्यूट योर माइक। I am sure now I am, you are able to hear me now.
Yes, sir,
Yes,
we
sir.
are listening.
All right. Okay. So these are the basic things, because the your grounded theory will be used only and only when you have the qualitative information. It cannot be used when you have a quantitative information. So this is one important point that I thought I should tell you, and that is why I have done all that. Another important is, you know the steps of the research, because research is a process. So steps are as follows. Number one step is identification of problem. So you have to identify the problem and you have to select the problem. So selection is a part of the identification. Identification is broader and selection is part of it. There is another word for problem is a variable. So ultimately you have to select a variable. The next step, which will be there whenever you have a qualitative research, and next step is data collection. But if you are doing a quantitative research, then second step is not data collection. The second step will be then formulation of hypothesis. But in the grounded theory, when you are using, you can't have hypothesis, because you cannot test it. So when you see the data collection, in this data collection, there are three things which you should know. One is the sampling. Another is you should know the tools. And another, you should know the method. These are the three important parts of it. And your grounded theory really starts working in this particular one, the data collection. Another is you have to have the data analysis. So your grounded theory starts working from step number two, it goes to step number three, and then naturally the step number four is your conclusion. So these are the steps which as a researcher you must follow as far as the grounded theory is concerned. Okay, now another point before I switch over to my another one, that you should know the variables. And I'm sure all of you know what is a variable. Another word for the variable is a problem. Problem and variable word can be used interchangeably, absolutely no problem. But you know variable. And these variables are of different types. One of the way to classify them as a continuous variable, and another can be a discontinuous variable. These are the two types of the variable which will be there everywhere. Whether you are doing a action, you are doing a qualitative research or a quantitative research, it doesn't make a difference. But in the grounded theory, you cannot use independent variable, dependent variable words. these words only to be used whenever you are conducting an experimental study. Since here you are not conducting an experimental study, so you cannot use independent variable, dependent variable, intervening variable whenever you are doing a qualitative research. Because the qualitative research can never be experimental in nature. When it has to be only the qualitative. So therefore, the variables which you have to consider is the continuous variable and the discontinuous variable or discrete variable. This is what you should know it very well. Another important point I want to tell you is that when I come to the data collection, you must have known two things, that when you have a qualitative data, you can analyze this qualitative data by using a technique called a content analysis. Okay? And another can be that when you have a qualitative data, you can analyze it by using this your grounded theory. So grounded theory and the content analysis both can be used for analyzing the qualitative information. But what is the difference? The difference is that if you have a qualitative information and if you want to convert that qualitative information into different classes, into different groups, into different categories. And those categories you can decide, absolutely no problem. So when you have a qualitative information and you want to analyze it in different categories, then this is what is called a content analysis. But if you do not do this, but if you want to just come out with some theory, you want to see the relationship between them. Whatever information you have, you should be able to see some relationship between them. And when you are trying to see the relationship, then you are not doing the content analysis, but you are using the grounded theory. Because the grounded theory really attempts or aims at studying the relationships. So therefore, when you have the qualitative data, you can analyze with the help of content analysis, and you can analyze with the help of grounded theory, along with there are many other, the qualitative, say, techniques, you might have studied all of them. So therefore, that is the difference between the content analysis and the grounded theory. Okay. Now, with this basic one, let me now start with that. Let us write the title. I'm writing the title and let us try to understand from the title, which title is more appropriate for the grounded theory, or where the data can be analyzed with the help of the grounded theory principles or the ideas, etc., etc. Say, if I say like this, a study, of home adjustment, of adolescent of adolescent males of Ujjain Suppose this is one title, another title is a study of cooperation among joint family members of rural area of Haryana. Another, I am saying a study of business strategy strategies of traders during Mughal period. Another, I am saying that a study of domestic violence during lockdown period in joint families of urban area of Lucknow. Let me have one more. A study of activities of retired males of Indore. See, I have given you some of these, the title, and now let us see where can you get a data which will be the qualitative in nature. Your first one is a study of home adjustment of adolescent males of Ujjain. Here, your variable is a home adjustment. So it's a variable and you have the tools for it. So therefore, and you, whatever the responses you have, you can quantify it. So the title number one is not appropriate where you want to use the grounded theory. Let us see the another one. Now here, this cooperation, you know, here this home adjustment is very simple variable. Cooperation is not as simple as home adjustment, because cooperation involves lot of other things. So therefore, in this particular one, a study of cooperation among joint family members of the rural area of Haryana, here, the information which you get will be qualitative in nature, and this qualitative information you can definitely analyze with the using the grounded theory. So this is quite all right. The third one is business strategies. you know, this business strategies, it's not a variable like home adjustment or variable like reasoning or variable like stress, because it's a complex one. Now here, the domestic violence is again a problem which is not simple. So therefore you can use the grounded theory for the second one. You can use the grounded theory for the third one, for the fourth one, and you can use the grounded theory for this one also, where a study of activities of retired males of Indore, that there are different males, might be female as well as males, but here it is males, you can't take females, and they are from Indore. So you can collect the data from them, and you can analyze using your what is known as the grounded theory. Okay, so therefore you have to write the title, and the title must be such so that it really fits into your system where you can use the grounded theory. With this little background, let me now go to the grounded theory one. Now I am just sharing my PPT with you people. See, I have already talked about basic and different types of the researches. I have talked about the steps of the research. Now I will be talking about what exactly is the grounded theory is. We must have a clear understanding of the grounded theory. Then when to use the grounded theory. And then the whole procedure of the grounded theory method, the tools which we use for collecting the information and which can be analyzed, then the process of coding. See, in content analysis, you do the coding, and here also you do the coding. So coding is common in content analysis as well as the grounded theory. But there coding the purpose, and here coding purpose is to see the relationships among different informations which you get. But there in content analysis, your purpose may not be just to understand the underlying theory or underlying relationships. Another is that there are two schools of the grounded theory. I will just compare them and tell you the difference between them, and then you can decide later on. Advantages and disadvantages of the grounded theory, and how exactly the grounded theory has to be evaluated. These are few of the things which I will like to take up. Now I go to the grounded theory. See, the grounded theory involves collection and analysis of the data. So this starts playing its role at the collection of the data and the analysis of the data. That means your grounded theory will be applicable from step number 2 and step number 3, which I have given you. The first step has to be there, because without first step, you cannot do the research. You have to have the identification of a problem. You must have a problem. But once you have the problem, then you collect the data, how data are to be collected, and then how data analysis has to be done. These are the two very, very important. Otherwise, the name is a little bit a confusing one, because it talks about the grounded theory method. You see? So it's a method in the sense that it is now used at step number 2, that is the data collection. And you should know how data collected and how data are analyzed. Here, the theory is grounded. You know the meaning of the grounded is embedded in what? The actual data that you are collecting, actual information that you have. whatever the information you have, in this particular information, the theory will be imbibed in it. It is grounded in it. It is hidden in it, and you have to take it out. So that's what exactly the grounded theory will be doing it. And that means you have to analyze and you have to develop the theory. Okay, so the whole data you should analyze in order to develop the theory. Okay, and this theory, which is to be developed after you have collected the data. Once you have started collecting the data, you know, theory building will start from there only. It is not that you collect the complete data and after that you do it. No. Both the collection of the data and the theory building or analysis of the data start simultaneously. They keep, as you keep on collecting and you keep on analyzing, you keep on collecting and you keep on analyzing, both have to be done simultaneously. In the other research, in the quantitative research, you analyze the data only and only after you have collected the entire data. That means whatever the sample size that you have here, and whatever the information you are taking from them, whatever information comes, keep on analyzing and keep on trying to see the relationship between whatever is hidden in those one. That's what exactly has to be done. And this particular method was developed by Glaser and Stress in 1967. It's very old. But I do not know, dear friends, when I was a student, we never studied this grounded theory. I do not know still that how many universities must be having grounded theory in their syllabus. So that means whatever the syllabus that we have, which we follow at master's level, or pre-PhD level, it needs to be modified. It needs to be upgraded. So therefore, this is a very old one, but we people have not started using. I'm sure some of you may like to take up a research where you may like to use this particular theory. Now, when to use the grounded theory? Number one is, when you need a broad theory or explanation of the process, whatever the process that happens, that takes place, if you want to explain this particular process, why it happened, how it happened, things of that variety, which will involve not one variable information, multivariables will be there. When I said the home adjustment, there I have taken only one variable. But when I said the cooperation, there are many variables involved in it. Okay, so therefore, this is very, very important information. So therefore, whenever you have you want a broader theory or an explanation of a process, you can use the grounded theory. It is especially useful when the current theories or the phenomena are either inadequate or non-existent. There might be the phenomena whether you really have the theory that explains the phenomena. If you have the theory, then I don't think you will like to find out a theory. But if you have a theory, but if you feel this theory is unable to explain the phenomena in total, phenomena means whatever you are seeing, whatever is happening into the society. if you are working on a problem which requires the observation in the society, the relationships among people, and things of that variety. So therefore, if those things are inadequate, then you really need to find out another one. So that's what has to be done. Or maybe you are observing many events and phenomena, but to explain those events, you do not have a theory which is underlying. And therefore, you have to develop that theory, and grounded theory you can use for developing that. It is useful when one wants to study the process. When you want to study the process, then of course you use it. For example, how high achieving women career develops. You know, there are many women, they are the CEOs of different companies. Now you want to really study how exactly that happened. Now you know, Kamala Harris now has become the vice president of US, the America. So you can study the whole process that has she has undergone, and now she has reached to this particular height. So if these type of the things you are interested, then the grounded theory, of course, you can say. Another can be how student develop writing skills. You know, the children right from the very beginning, you know, how parents help the children in developing the writing skill, in developing the other skills required for even day-to-day life also, and for others also. So such type of thing, if you are interested, you can use the grounded theory. Absolutely no problem in that. In the grounded theory, you will have a qualitative information. So textual database will be there. Textual, which may be in words or maybe in the, you know, paragraphs or things like this, or maybe sometime in the pictures form, etc., etc. And you have to label them. So the textual material which you have, that is your data, that you have to label, means you have to put them into categories. So whatever information you have, the qualitative information, they have to be categorized. If some of you are the science students, you know the periodical table, how periodical table came up, the classification. That's the very important thing. And you know that in day-to-day life also, you must be seeing that in offices, lot of the communication keeps on going on through letters. So office people receive large number of letters, and they try to classify the letters. And you must have noticed that there is only one file which is the thickest one, and that file is miscellaneous file. What is the meaning that? Miscellaneous means the paper, the letter which has come to your office, you are unable to classify, then you put it under that miscellaneous. That means we do not have the competency to categorize. And categorization is a higher mental ability. So therefore, dear friends, if you are interested in using the grounded theory to analyze your qualitative data, then it is must that you should have the analytical ability. And if your analytical ability is weak, then you will not be able to really analyze the qualitative data using the grounded theory. No, you cannot. Okay, so this is very important information that I am giving you. Now, so you can categorize them you may try to see the information and see whether some new concepts are coming up or not out of this, or some new properties are coming up. There might be concepts, there might be properties, there might be categories, and these will be from your textual material, your qualitative information. I'm emphasizing qualitative information. And you have to see the relationship amongst whatever the categories you have or concepts you have or property. You have to see the relationships among them. Sometimes the data may not be in textual in nature. I told you the data may be in words or maybe in picture form or in some other form also. So therefore, it's not that always you have the textual material, the textual data. The data might be your observation of a behavior. You know, when you are in a group, when somebody is talking or somebody is behaving, the other people, they do observe their behavior. How the people interact. You know, when on the TV, when you see the prime minister interacting with the CEOs, when the prime minister interacts with the students, how exactly he interacts, how he initiates that interaction is a very important thing. How different events which are taking place into your classroom, the interaction is taking place, interaction is between student and teacher. It must be among the students also. So that's what you have to observe. And from those behaviors, that's what the data which you will be collecting, the information which you will be having it. Now, most of the data are in the form of field notes. They will be qualitative. See, when you conduct this type of research, if you are observing the people, you keep on taking down the notes. I'm sure you know that whenever a student is making a presentation, then you do make notes. You do note down some of the salient points. You may not be able to note down each and every sentence, but you must be noting down the word which gives the meaning of that particular sentence. So these notes you have to have. And therefore that forms your diary. You have a, you know, some of you are maintaining your diary and you, this all qualitative information you have, maybe some quantitative also in that. Now, if you take your diary and start analyzing, you may use a grounded theory, not content analysis, provided you have the theme. Now, the tools for the data collection in this one will be interviews you can use, observation schedules you can use, some documents which are there available, already available somewhere, like your diary, etc., etc. Or it may be some historical record of certain events which have taken place. Maybe your photographs are there. You know, when there is a program, you know, annual program or anything, and you are taking a part, and people do take the pictures and therefore try to combine and see what exactly comes out of it. It may be videotapes. These are the different, see here, you do not use test. Here, you do not use scales. Here, you do not use inventories. Please understand, in the grounded theory, whatever the data that you will be collecting will be with the help of these, the interview schedule, observation schedule, document, historical records, videotapes. And these tools are unstandardized tools. you can never standardize them. So the the grounded theory, when you are using it for qualitative data, and whenever you are collecting the qualitative data with the help of the tool, these tools will be unstandardized tools. So please understand, if your tools are unstandardized, you absolutely have no idea about its reliability, about its validity. And that may be one of the negative part of the grounded theory, as it is the negative part of all qualitative research. Because once you have the data which is qualitative in nature, this data, you don't know whether really you should have a faith on this particular data or not, whether it really reflects the real event or a hidden event or not. So therefore, from the grounded theory, when you analyze the qualitative data, then naturally generalization cannot take place. Absolutely no. Even if 100 people are taking the same problem and they conduct a research and they come out with the findings, some theory, that may not be generalized. It's not possible. Because the data that you have got, you don't know whether it's really a reliable one or not. This is one of the strong weaknesses of the qualitative research in general, and of course, grounded theory. Now, see, when you are using the interview schedule, it has to be open-ended. You cannot have closed. I'm sure you know the difference between closed and open-ended. The closed means where you give certain, say, suppose during COVID period, people might have felt some problem. So if you want to have a closed one, then you have to list different problems and ask people of these, which one you faced. But if it is an open-ended question, then you just ask the people that during COVID period, the different problems which you might have faced, you may like to spell them out or you may like to put it. So therefore you may ask and they may narrate it or they may list it, whatever they like, they can do it. So the interview cannot be closed. It has to be open. Okay. So it is not the structured one. It's more unstructured. It can be questionnaire also. That's an interview schedule and questionnaire, both are same. Only the difference is you are using question interview schedule only for a select people and questionnaire for mass. So here, when you are saying interviewing, it is your questionnaire can also be there or your interview schedule can also be there, no problem. Then another is your observation, your participant observation, your focused group. You know, when people are working in a particular situation, then you can see how each person is contributing. And this, you know, is being used by people belonging to army. When they recruit people, all candidates are supposed to be staying at a place. And they have one psychologist. The psychologist keep on observing the behavior of the people when they are in the field or when they are in the mess or when they are in their rooms or when they are in the say just walking, etc., etc. Because through that you can reveal lot of other aspect of that particular person. So participant observation is very, very important one. And that's what, of course, you have to do as far as the qualitative is concerned. You know, there are a lot of programs are coming on the TV. Your reality shows are there. You know, there you can keep on observing how a person is standing and how a person is talking and things of that variety. So you can have a focus group also. There are certain artifacts are there, certain facts are there, some texts are there, textual material. The general theory can be broken down into two. One is the method and the product. The method means the procedure, the steps which you are using, and by following those steps, then you come to the product. So your general theory, when you are developing the theory, you are breaking down first, and then after that, you are combining and coming out with the product. It is, if you know the Bloom's taxonomy, it is analysis and synthesis. So this will involve analysis, and it will also involve synthesis. Those people who are weak in analysis, they will not be able to come out with something, a concrete one. The theory will not be possible for you. The process of coding you must know, because this is the crux of the grounded theory. If you are able to understand and do it, then fine. Otherwise, no. Of course, you have the data. So coding jo hai, it has to be done line by line. You read one line and then try to code it, read another line, read it, not word. I'm not saying word, I'm saying line. Because once you read a line, it gives you a meaning. So therefore you should code it. Okay? Then that is the meaning of a coding. It can be open coding. I have told you coding is line by line. It has to be open coding. That means read through data several times. Sometime you have to read. And when you are reading it, sometime you do not focus on each and every word. It is possible that when you first read it, you may not really, or your focus doesn't go on very important word, but you read it again, then it happens that quite possible you may focus on that word which you did not do in the first one. So many a times, you know, when you have a letter, you must have experience that you read that letter many a times. And when you read that letters many a time, you start understanding, oh my God, so many informations are given in that one. So that's a very important thing. So open coding means you have to read that particular, the whatever the material you have many a times. And then you should keep on making some summaries. That is very important. That is your first step. That's what you have to do. Then, you know, actual coding, you know, that some of you are from, maybe from science, you know, there is a, when you make a graph, then in making a graph, there is a x-axis and there is a y-axis. That's what exactly meaning of the actual coding. That means you have to see the, what are the things which are coming on one particular, in one particular category, and what are the things which are coming in another particular category. Okay? And you are doing that just to create the conceptual families. so that you are able to put them in groups and put them in families. Okay? All right. And that is followed by selective coding. So first your open coding, next your axial coding, and the third one is your selective coding. So it turns the families into formal framework with a variable that includes the collected data. So this is, so these are the three important the words. One is open coding, another is axial coding, another is selective coding. Of course, I cannot demonstrate it right now here because of the time constraint. Otherwise, I would have loved to take some of the qualitative information, and then I should have done some open coding and then axial coding and then selective coding. But these are the three crux, or you can say the grounded theory centers around these three important concepts, the open coding, the axial coding, and the selective coding. Now, important considerations in the grounded theory. One is you have to identify the area of the interest. Whose interest? The researchers. Interest means what? The objective. What the researcher is interested in, that's a very important thing. Okay? Another, in this one, important, you should not have preconceived notion. Or you should not think that when you are analyzing this, will you be finding this? No, you do not. You should not start with preconceived notion or preconceived theory. Absolutely no. Because once you start with the preconceived theory, then you will not be able to come up with a new theory. And you have to come up with a new theory only and only when you just forget about the preconceived type of things. And you have to focus on the new data. That's what is there. It's a very important thing. Okay? The another is you have to use the theoretical sensitivity. See, sensitivity is very important. That means an awareness, subtle message and meaning. You have to be very, very sensitive that whatever the qualitative information you have, what is the message that is coming out and what is the meaning? Sometimes there may be a message and you may not be able to find out meaning. You know, sometimes you have meaningless information. I'm sure all of you must be having some experience when you say, oh, this information is not meaningful. I'm not able to make out any head and tail. But here, you have to make out that. And if there is a information where there is no meaning, then you can ignore that type of information. The researcher stops when one has reached the theoretical saturation. You know, there is a saturation point. You know that there is a saturated solution. Saturated means that you cannot go beyond it. And you have exhausted all information, whatever you have. So if you have left out some information, then the theoretical saturation cannot come. So the theoretical saturation will come only and only if all data that you have collected, you have exhausted it, you have analyzed it, you have very minutely you have analyzed and tried to see the relationship between different informations. That is what is very important. And this point is where one has sampled and analyzed the data, which is I have said that whatever data you are collecting, you have exhausted it. Okay, so that theoretical saturation must come. Some other salient features of grounded theory are coding, I have said, that means labeling and categorizing. Okay, from the collected data, you have to do the labeling and you have to categorize it. There is a social process. You know, when you have the data, you may try to find out whether it reflects some social processes. You know, there are different social meeting people, talking to it, you know, etc. There are, you are having a parties, etc. and going to the movie and park, social processes some. You have to see, are there certain abstract categories? Abstractness is very important. And dear friends, there are two things. You know, it has to be done intuitively. Intuition plays a very important role here. Abstract categories, not concrete. These categories are refined using theoretical sampling. You can refine them by collecting more data and things of that variety. It is possible. Another is that the gap between coding and the writing, you are coding and side by side you are writing, it has to be bridged with the memorandums. There are memorandums, you are taking the notes. So these notes are to be analyzed. And when you are analyzing these notes, then whatever the gap happens between the coding and the writing part, those gaps you can fill in. And that is why you have to read the same information many a times. And this is done because the gap should not be there, and therefore you have exhausted the complete data. The categories are integrated. Whatever the categories that you are coming out, they have not to be separate. In content analysis, they are separate. But in this, you have to see the relationship between them. And therefore, you have to develop a theoretical framework. This theoretical framework is not the preconceived earlier. No, it is a fresh, because you started doing it with a fresh mind. So important. Another important is that that once research is based in the grounded theory and must follow the explicit sequential guidelines. You have to follow the sequential guidelines which just now I have told you, the coding, etc., coding axis, and then, you know, those you have to follow. Many a times you do not use one method, you may use different methods. You know, when you are collecting the data, you know, you can use different methods of collecting the data. The data analysis, one is a open coding, that's what important thing that you have to do. That means you are dividing the data into smaller segment, scrutinize for commonality. See, whatever you are trying to divide, I said analysis and synthesis, that is applicable here. That you are analyzing and side by side you are synthesizing. And when you are synthesizing, you are trying to find out the commonness amongst the different segments, among the different parts, among the different informations. And so that you emerge with a theme, a particular theme or a particular category. And after the data are categorized, they are further examined for the properties and characterize each category. So you have to further examine them. Once you have come up with a theme or come up with a categories, try to take more information and see whether it really stands or it changes. Open coding is a process of reducing the data. You are reducing, you have collected huge amount of data, and this data you have to reduce, because when you are classifying them into categories or themes, then you are reducing. It's a basically a data reduction one. So that's what you have to do. And coding is the process of naming or labeling the categories or the properties. In the coding, you can start naming also. You can start to say labeling also. Naming, labeling, one of the same thing. This is the first one, the open coding. The second one is your actual coding. Your discrete codes are grouped according to the conceptual. Once you have done the coding, then you have to see those and try to synthesize and have a conceptual categories that reflects the commonalities. If you cannot find the commonalities, then of course the theory cannot be built. So synthesis keeps on going. It reflects the idea of clustering the open code around specific axes, either x-axis or y-axis, whatever, mean around a particular theme, around a particular point. And that theme must emerge from the data. It's not, you cannot have preconceived one. It must emerge from the data. And the third is selective coding. In this one, researcher treats various codes, clusters in a selective fashion, deciding how they are related. You know, you see the relationship and then you may like to tell the story type of thing by putting the, connecting them the dot and making a theory. So once you come up with a theory, story type of thing, that story is your real finding. And therefore, once you do a selective one, it comes up with a story type of thing, a thing, and that you can narrate, that you can tell. And that's what is your, the finding of that particular one. That here analyzed a set of rational statements that can be used to explain in a general sense what is going on. So that's what your story, what exactly, what happened first, then what happened second, and things of that variety you have to do. So these are the three important aspects: the selective coding, the actual coding, and one, your open coding, actual coding, and selective coding. These are the three important things that you have to understand. Now, data analysis should happen at the same time of data collection. I have already told you. Say in your experimental study, you have to collect the data and then you analyze it. In your survey study, you have to collect, in your philosophical one, you have to collect the data. In historical, you have to collect and then analyze it. But in this particular one, you have to collect and simultaneously you have to keep on analyzing. But in, so that is why it fits into survey, descriptive survey. So it's a part of the descriptive survey, not correlational survey. Okay, because correlational survey requires your quantitative information. But here you may not have quantity, you have more qualitative information. So therefore, once you collect the data and you keep on analyzing it side by side, both the things should keep on going. You should not wait till you have collected the entire data. No. And when you are analyzing the, you are coming up with some new theory or some new ideas, whatever is there. It is a concurrent data analysis and data side by side. Both these things, collection and analysis, keeps on going simultaneously, and then you come out with some theory or something like that. Now, dear friend, this is another important one, that here the two models, they are, or schools of thought of the grounded theory are being compared. One is a Glaser one, another is a Corbin. Okay, in the Glaser one, you have the general idea, starts with the general idea of where to begin. So you begin with the general idea, but here starts with the general idea where okay, you have to start with the general idea of where to begin. So you do not have okay, the first point is same in both the cases. Second point, it is the neutral question that you are using here. It's not to the one. In Corbin. So in the Glaser one, it is the neutral question you are using, but in the Corbin ones, the structured questions you are using. In the Glaser one, you are developing the conceptual theory. So you are developing the conceptual theory, that the Glaser one. And conceptual description is the Corbin. Here you are not developing the theory, you are just describing. But what I have explained you is the Glaser, where you are coming up with a theory. Then another is the development of theoretical sensitivity. From the sensitivity from immersion of the in the data. You have to immerse into the data and then you come up with some theoretical sensitivity. And here, the development of theoretical sensitivity from methods and the tool. You are using methods and the tool, and here the data that you have, you are. The theory is grounded in the data, whatever is the data, the information you have, the theory is inbuilt in that. And you have to take out that. Whereas in Corbin one, the theory is interpreted by the observer. Another is the basic social process should be identified as far as Glaser is concerned. And Corbin is that basic social process need not to be identified. You need not to identify the social processes, but as far as the Glaser is concerned, you have to identify the social process. Another is that in the Glaser one, the researcher is passive, exhibiting disciplinary restraint. And in the Corbin one, the researcher is active. In the Glaser one, data reveals the theory. In Corbin one, data is structured to reveal the theory. You have to structure the data to review. But here, data itself will reveal the theory. That's what the difference. In the Glacier one, coding and continuous comparison of data enables the pattern to energy. You keep on doing both the things simultaneously. Here, coding is defined by technique, leading to the micro analysis of the data word by word. Then in the Glacier one, uses two coding phases to develop the concept. And the Corbin one uses three types, that is open, axial, and the selective one, which I have told you. Then here, in the Glacier one, the true grounded theory comes up, and here it is regarded as form of qualitative theory analysis that grounded the theory. So these are some of the differences. Now, advantages of the grounded theory. Number one is that researchers should not predetermine. You should not predetermine some theory. No, absolutely no. Okay. Another, the grounded theory is it avoids making assumptions. There are no assumptions. And instead adopts a more neutral view of the human actions in the social context. The grounded theory provides a methodology to develop an understanding of social phenomena, okay? That is not preformed or pre-theorized, no, it's not. The pre-theoretically developed, no, you are not developing, it emerges out from the data. Then as an exploratory method, the grounded theory particularly well suited for investigating social processes that have attracted little prior research attention. You can understand the social processes. Where the previous researches are lacking, you can use that. And where new point of view emerge on the familiar topics. You know, this you can explore more. Grounded theory can identify the suited nature of the knowledge as well as contingent nature of the practice. Grounded theory produces thick description. Okay. That acknowledges the area of conflict and the contradictions. The grounded theory is better at determining what actually happens. As a general theory, ground theory adapts the research to study the diverse phenomena. Grounded theory can respond and change. You can change as the conditions changes, so the things can change. The grounded theory has intuitive appeal for researchers since it allows them to become immersed in the data. So intuitiveness is very important. Researchers have to analyze the data early. You collect and you keep on analyzing. As soon as you, one day, whatever data you have collected, you can start analyzing. Next day, whatever you collect, you start analyzing. It encourages systematic and detailed analysis of the data that I have said. Researchers need ample evidence to back up their claims. You should have a lot of data, a lot of information to say something, if you are saying the participant was active, then you should have some data, some information to say, see, these informations reveal that the participant was active. And if you do not have, then of course, it's not possible. Then of course, you can keep on moving from data collection to data analysis. So that's a simultaneously you have to do it. Useful for describing the repeated process. But there are some disadvantages. One disadvantage is grounded theories fails to recognize the embeddedness of the researcher and thus not clearly expressed by the researcher's data analysis and interpretation. Okay, then grounded theory tend to produce large amount of data. And many a times you are not able to really manage that particular data. This is another disadvantage. Researcher need to be skillful in using the grounded theory. You must have a lot of practice in analyzing the qualitative data using the grounded theory. And they're in using grounded theory, there are no standard rules to follow. You cannot say that you do this first and you do this and you do absolutely wrong. As the data comes, as you have information, analyze, categorize, and try to build up the theory. That's what you have to do simultaneously. Now, you know, when you use for the first time, then you know you may be using a lot of coding. And you know, when you use a lot of codes, then you lose the track. Because you are excited when you have a lot of data, so start using the coding and large number of coding. And at the end, you are not able to connect the dots. You are not able to see the relationships among them. So that's very important, and that is one of the disadvantages you should not. And this open coding, it takes a lot of time. It's a time consuming. It can be difficult to scale up to large concepts. This is not easy to come up with a particular theory, you know, very difficult. It is difficult to see the bigger picture, you know, because it is a detailed method. Bigger picture you cannot see, very difficult. Tends to produce lower level theories. The grounded theory cannot help you to give a higher order theory. It's a very, very minimum level of theory you can generate. It cannot generate a high quality theory. This is another disadvantage of this. So if you want to use the grounded theory and you think that you can come up with a good theory, the answer is no. Now, if you have to evaluate the grounded theory, some of the points you have to consider. Number one, is there an obvious connection between the categories and the raw data? When you are evaluating a research where the grounded theory has been used, then you have to see whether there is an obvious connection between the categories, whatever the researcher has come up, and the data, whatever the raw data the person had. Another is the theory useful as a conceptual explanation of the process? Can it explain the process? Another is, does the theory produce a relevant explanation of actual problem and the basic process. And another is the theory modified as conditions changes? Because as the conditions changes, the theory has to be modified. So is the theory modified as the conditions change? You know, once the researcher starts collecting the additional data, you have collected the data and you have come up with a particular theory. Suppose now you collect another more data, then the theory that you have already come up will change because the new data will bring new information. So important is, that is why whatever you will say only on the basis of this data which you have collected. If you change the data, then the theory that you have built up is likely to change. This is very important information. Then ask about the process of the research is, is a theoretical model developed or generated? Are you developing a model or it is generating a model? See, you are developing a model. It is not generated. Okay? Is the intent of the model to conceptualize a process or an action or interaction? Is there a central phenomena, the core category? Okay, that's what you should have. And another is that does the model emerge through the phases of the coding? When you do the different phases, those three phases, whether your model is emerging from that or not. So these are some of the salient features, dear friends. I don't know whether I have helped you to understand some of these things or not. If not, then it is my fault. It's not the fault of anyone else. So now it's over to the organizer. If you have to ask any question, then people can ask question. Absolutely no problem.
Hello.
Yes.
If anybody have question, please raise. Please add the chat box.
I don't think anyone has question.
Good evening, sir. Can I ask something?
Go ahead.
Sir, can you please give a practical example of coding?
Sorry, I have said right in the beginning, I could have given a practical example, but because the time constraints, it's very difficult. You know, if you have to talk about the grounded theory, you need at least 6 to 7 hours to understand it, because you should have it to do the coding and then come up with a theory. So sorry, I cannot do it. Next question.
Good evening, sir.
Good evening, Mirza ji, boliye.
Sir, I'm Mirza Ahmed Afzal Farooq.
Ha, boliye,
from
sir.
Central University of Jammu. Sir, I have a question related to, hello.
Go ahead.
Sir, if I want to guide my scholar who is intending to do research novels, novel of any novelist, and there I plan to make use of the theory of Michel Foucault.
Go ahead.
Yeah. So in that case, will it come under the category of grounded theory?
I am very doubtful. I think it comes under the category of the content analysis.
Absolutely, sir. Absolutely. So in that case, in that.
Yes. Go ahead, Mirza.
In that case, my analysis of the novel in the light of the theory of Michel Foucault.
Nay, I don't know, because I'm not from literature, but I can tell you grounded theory will not be applicable. applicable. There it is, the content analysis will be more applicable.
Okay, okay. Fine.
So I'm unable to understand the other part of what you are saying because I have not read and I don't know. But one thing I can say that when you have a qualitative data in literature, it is the content analysis is more important.
Okay.
Any other?
Thank you, sir.
Any other question?
Good evening, sir.
Good evening, Kirti. Go ahead.
Sir, I have heard about Lady Charmas, who have also given the base of grounded theory. And right. According to Charmas, there are two levels of coding, open coding and focused coding. So how should we go? Which one is better? Is there any?
Actually, it depends upon the researcher. If you really understand it, then you go ahead with it. Because it's very difficult to say which theory, the grounded theory, are better than the other one. In this one right now, I have said it has the three steps. In you, you have the two steps. Anyone can be used, no problem at all. I don't see any problem in that. But if you understand those two, you can go ahead with that.
Okay. Thank you, sir.
Any other question? Hello.
Any book suggested for the topic?
Hello.
Any book suggested for the topic?
Actually, there are many books right on grounded theory. You can take that book and then you can read it. There are many books available. Shipra publication is one which will give you the, you know, varieties, at least on the qualitative one. They have quantitative, but qualitative also. So if you can catch hold of Shipra, you know, the catalog, you can find the books. And they are on grounded theory. Next.
Sir, for research purpose, if we are using grounded theory, is there any guidelines for the number of participants?
No. The sample size depends upon you.
Sir, still it is from 10 to 20 or 50 to 60. Because there is numerous amount of data in this qualitative research.
Let me tell you, Kirti, if you have, let us say, 500 people. Think it yourself, if you have the data from 500 and each one is having, let's say, 3 pages, will you be able to really analyze that much data?
No, sir. That's why I'm asking, is there any guideline 20 to 50 is okay or not?
They do not have any guidelines, but from quantitative, there is a guideline. And you know, in quantitative, if you have the collected data from 30 people, you know, then it means your sample size is large. If you have collected less than 30, then your sample size is small. So your sample size can be determined. There is no doubt about it. And there are different sampling, determining sample size. You can use a Google also, and they can tell you this should be size of your sample. So accordingly, in this also, you can use that. No problem at all. Once you know your population size.
Okay. Thank you, sir.
Any other question?
Sir, can we use grounded theory for medical sciences?
For medical science, you can use grounded theory. Wherever you have a qualitative information, you can use. Absolutely no problem. You can use in agriculture also if you have the qualitative information. Wherever qualitative information generated, gets collected, the grounded theory can be used. If someone is from nursing, you can use it. From medical science, you can use, absolutely no problem. Next.
Sir, we have very much little time to finish the program. So I am inviting Dr. Archana Srivastava for thanksgiving, vote of thanks.
Okay.
And many, many thanks to you, sir.
Thank you very much.
Honorable Chief Guest, Dr. D.N. Srivastava, sir. Haji, sir.
Please open your video.
Okay, sir. Okay, sir. Okay, sir. Are you hearing me?
Yes.
Okay, sir. Namaskar, sir. Honorable Chief Guest, Dr. D.N. Srivastava, sir. Dr. Arvind Jha, respected director, Mr. Prayas Gautam, and Mr. Samadhan Gautam. Respected principal, Dr. Harshash Sagar, teachers, and my dear friends. Good evening, all of you. BCG Shiksha Mahavidyalaya Devas Dwara Ayojit Gunatmak Anusandhan Par इस 7 दिवसीय फैकल्टी डेवलपमेंट प्रोग्राम में हमारे मुख्य वक्ता डॉक्टर अरविंद झा की मैं हृदय से आभारी हूं। आपने गुणात्मक अनुसंधान और उसके प्रकारों को विस्तृत रूप से हम सबके समक्ष बड़ी सहजता से प्रस्तुत किया। मैं आदरणीय सर डॉक्टर संसनवा सर की हृदय से आभारी हूं। आपने संक्षिप्त सूचना के साथ हमारे से शामिल हुए और हमारा मार्गदर्शन किया। ये मेरे लिए एक बहुत अच्छा अनुभव था। सर आप ज्वाइन हुए हमारे साथ, थैंक यू सर। मैं हमारे संस्था के डायरेक्टर मिस्टर प्रयास गौतम, मिस्टर समाधान गौतम, इनकी आभारी हूँ इस कार्यक्रम को आयोजित करने की हमें अनुमति दी और हमारा सहयोग किया। मैं मिस्टर डॉक्टर प्रमोद कुमार गुप्ता की और उनके उनकी टीम की हृदय से आभारी हूँ। आपने
Archana ma'am is facing technical problem. Many, many thanks to you, all learners, all resource persons, on behalf of teachers, Indian Teacher Education Community and BCG College of Devas. And we will organize another programs on qualitative research and quantitative research. We will inform at the group. Thank you. Many, many.
Hello, Pramod sir.